can stop and start if I need to. All right, we will start this again. Hello, and welcome to our third lecture. Today we are going to discuss different general approaches to treating female victims of intimate partner violence, or IPV, with problematic substance use, PSU. However, before we review these different approaches, it is important to note that typically IPV and PSU are treated separately, which can lead to several issues that can hinder progress in one or both areas. Due to the fact that most PSU treatment is provided for both men and women in a gender-blind way, services are usually not differentiated for women. This can be problematic when serving women, especially those who are currently or formerly in abusive relationships. This is because they face unique gender-related issues that can weaken each stage of PSU treatment, such as social stigma or gender stereotypes, which often leads to feelings of guilt and shame, especially when children and custody issues are involved. For example, abusers in active IPV cases typically would not allow their victims to enter into any treatment services, especially inpatient ones, as this could weaken the control they have over their victim. Even after the relationship is over, the trauma faced by survivors of IPV can greatly weaken feelings of trust, making it difficult to move through the various stages of treatment. For single mothers, the effects of withdrawal that typically occur when entering into drug treatment could jeopardize their ability to take care of children and/or could hurt their chances to retain child custody. Another common problem when services are not integrated is that IPV support providers often will only serve women if they are sober. In these situations, victims of IPV are turned away and might never return. One way to avoid this would be to make direct referrals to treatment support so that women can begin recovery as soon as possible. A third factor is that problematic substance use is often used by victims of IPV as a respite from their abuse. In other words, treatment will probably not be effective until the abusive relationship is addressed. Conversely, PSU is sometimes exploited by abusers to maintain control over their partners. Thus, helping a woman to deal with her addiction can take away an important lever used by abusers. As a result, it is not surprising that research indicates that services for both IPV and PSU are more effective when they are treated together in the same program or treatment center. Simultaneous treatment of IPV and PSU have recently begun to take center stage within the scientific community. Such approaches should be holistic, comprehensive, gender-sensitive, and trauma-informed. With this in mind, let us now discuss some of the most prevalent approaches used in the field. Remember, these are not one-size-fits-all approaches, but rather are typically combined by service providers to ensure that support addresses all of the various dimensions of the complexities that surround concurrent IPV and PSU. However, as we will see, great care should be taken in mixing these approaches because there is tension between some of their elements. Gender-sensitive and feminist approaches to treatment of IPV victims with PSU can help to prevent secondary victimization by identifying the ways that social and gender inequalities affect women's vulnerability to PSU and their capacity for change. These approaches seek to avoid victim blaming and stigmatization that sometimes occurs without service providers realizing it. These approaches help IPV and PSU professionals to change their attitudes, beliefs, and behavior towards clients to ensure that women do not feel blamed for being in the situations they are in. As a result, the gender inequities that affect PSU treatments are recognized and addressed. For example, PSU support groups might be formed only with women, or only with women who are survivors of IPV. The duration of PSU treatment stages might be lengthened for victims of IPV, giving them the time needed to address other issues. A gender-sensitive approach will also critically examine typical practices used in providing IPV support. For example, the practice of making referrals for couples therapy to address domestic violence cases. Instead, each case should be closely examined, and couples counseling should only be used if it will not lead to greater harm to the woman. When it comes to trauma-informed approaches, professionals are encouraged to view the traumatized individual as a whole, instead of perceiving IPV and PSU as separate problems to be addressed. A trauma-informed approach seeks to empower women and to develop their feelings of physical and emotional safety. By helping women to make informed and free decisions, IPV and PSU professionals can promote those women's need for self-determination. As a result, victims can begin to feel confident in making their own choices and in regaining control of their lives. Increased feelings of self-worth and efficacy are vitally important for women attempting to leave an abuser or seek sobriety. Trauma-informed approaches also seek to prevent re-traumatization by ensuring that trauma triggers are avoided. This includes taking into consideration the physical environment in which the treatment takes place, as well as clients' interactions with professionals. For example, victims of IPV should probably not receive services from an unknown person in an isolated location, as this can increase fear and safety concerns. At the same time, services should not be provided in public settings, where client anxieties and feelings of stigma can be triggered. Professionals must seek to understand how clients think about their situation and use these same thinking processes to change their behavior. The most prevalent evidence-based trauma-informed approaches include cognitive behavioral therapy, or CBT, which seeks to help clients to recognize, avoid, and cope with triggers or relapses in their drug use. Relational therapy seeks to help individuals recognize the important role that relationships play in shaping our experiences, well-being, and feelings of self-esteem. It helps clients to understand patterns appearing in the thoughts and feelings they have toward themselves. Mindfulness is a type of meditation in which the person focuses on being intensely aware of what they are sensing and feeling in the moment without interpretation or judgment. Mindfulness can involve the use of specific breathing methods as well as guided imagery, which is a form of focused relaxation used to create calm, peaceful images in the mind, offering a mental escape from trauma. In line with gender-sensitive and trauma-informed approaches, the whole-person, strength-based approach seeks to look not just at the multiple problems faced by women survivors of IPV with PSU issues, but instead focuses on the strengths and assets that can be built upon to effectively deal with these issues. As a result, the approach focuses less on how clients are damaged or broken, and instead on empowering women to overcome their problems. An important objective of the strengths-based approach is to protect the client's independence, resilience, decision-making ability, and well-being. Supporting the person's strengths can help address their need for support in a way that allows them to lead and be in control of their life as much as possible. The term strength refers to different elements that help or enable the individual to deal with challenges in life in general. They also can help to meet specific needs and to achieve long-term goals. Relevant strengths include their personal resources, abilities, skills, or knowledge, their social network and its resources, abilities, and skills, for example, friends or family, and community resources that should be capitalized upon, such as NGOs, schools, or support groups. The strengths-based approach also looks at the strengths that a service or support provider brings. Emphasis is placed on the collaborative process that takes place between the service provider and recipient. Working together, they can determine an outcome, such as leaving a partner, staying sober for 30 days, or finding a job or an apartment, that draws on the client's strengths and assets. A vital component to this is the quality of the relationship that develops between those providing and those being supported. When it comes to the approaches of treating people with addictions abstinence approaches are some of the most common. The aim of abstinence is to completely refrain from the use of any problematic substances. This approach is based on the disease model of addiction, which describes an addiction as a diagnosable chronic and progressive disease with biological, neurological, psychological, genetic, environmental, or sociological sources of origin. Furthermore, the abstinence approach assumes that people with substance use disorders are always at risk of a relapse, and that the safest way to prevent a relapse is to avoid substance use entirely. This strategy also removes unnecessary temptations from a patient's life. Abstinence approaches can create intense feelings of withdrawal, which can be especially problematic for women, and especially those dealing with the effects of IPV. Organizations such as Alcoholics and Narcotics Anonymous require abstinence as part of their self-help ethos. People attending AA or NA are encouraged to follow a set of 12 guiding principles. Fundamental to moving through the 12 steps is the person completing the first step and accepting that they are powerless to control their addiction or compulsion to drink or use drugs. There is usually a spiritual element to this program, and people following it are encouraged to look to support from a higher power, although some followers would say that this is optional. People are encouraged to get support from a sponsor who can be contacted at times of crisis and potential relapse. The sponsor relationship can be challenging to develop among victims of IPV because of lower levels of trust. Somewhat opposed to these approaches is the theory of social learning. This is a psychosocial theory that proposes that drug or alcohol use is learned from others. As addiction is primarily learned and not the result of biological or genetic factors, anyone at any time can develop a problem with alcohol or drugs, which may be in response to emotional distress, such as bereavement or domestic violence. Addiction continues because the user gets some reward for doing so, such as feeling high, relaxed, or to reduce pain or escape difficult situations. Practitioners of this social learning approach believe that learned behavior can be unlearned. They work with clients to change the way they view their own and other people's drug and alcohol use, for example, by identifying better ways to cope with difficult situations, such as domestic violence. Also differing from abstinence approaches are harm reduction approaches, which take a value-neutral perspective on drug use. The immediate goal in such approaches is not to achieve complete or even partial abstinence from drugs or alcohol, but to reduce the negative effects of substance use for individuals, communities, and societies. Harm reduction occurs gradually in a step-by-step progression toward decreased levels of overall harm. One common example is needle exchange and supervised injection sites to reduce the spread of disease. Another example is methadone maintenance treatment programs, which have been found to be extremely effective in the long-term reduction of the use of illicit opioids such as heroin, fentanyl, and oxycodone. Methadone treatment has also been found to significantly reduce the rates of withdrawal and cravings associated with opioid dependence. Implicit in harm reduction approaches is the recognition that the harm caused by PSU is not uniform across different substances. For example, one American study of 24 states over 12 years between 2005 and 2016 found a correlation between decriminalization of marijuana and a reduction of serious injury in domestic assaults. Harm reduction's philosophy considers PSU as a complex and inevitable part of life, and as such should be acknowledged and not judged. In this way, harm reduction interventions enable professionals to declare empathy for clients by acknowledging and respecting the fact that they may not be ready, willing, or able to pursue sobriety at a particular time. Thus, harm reduction approaches closely align to whole person, strength-based, and trauma-informed approaches in that they all seek to empower clients by validating their choices and avoiding re-victimization by service providers. However, like all other approaches, women often face unique challenges when accessing harm reduction services. Societal stigma prevents women from accessing harm reduction services for fear of their drug use becoming publicly known. As a result, women are more likely to hide their addiction and are less likely to be approached by outreach workers. Even when they do come into contact, service provider stigma can further dissuade women from accessing harm reduction services. For example, experiences of arrest, harassment, and violence by law enforcement officers are not uncommon. These experiences can also push women and gender nonconforming people away from mainstream harm reduction services. Self-stigma caused by perceived gender expectations and experience stigma can reduce health-seeking behaviors of women, further reducing their access to harm reduction. Formal barriers can also prevent certain women from accessing services. This includes restrictions on pregnant women or mothers. Harm reduction services are rarely offered in prisons, limiting access for incarcerated women. Even where services are available in prisons, willingness to access such services is low due to controls on access, breaches of confidentiality, and additional stigma felt within prison cultures. Furthermore, few harm reduction services are designed specifically for women. As a result, they are poorly integrated with other relevant services, such as for sexual and reproductive health and childcare. This lack of services reinforces the perception that harm reduction facilities are masculine spaces, thus discouraging access by those who do not identify as male. Finally, gender-based violence can stifle women's autonomy and cause victims to deprioritize harm reduction practices. Conversely, in cases where women are at an immediate risk of violence, avoiding treatment could be seen as a rational response to the situation, almost a harm reduction action in itself. Finally, as discussed previously, few social services are willing or capable to address co-occurring IPV and PSU as interrelated phenomena, meaning that women are often left out of one or both. In our next session, we will explore how some of these approaches can be integrated to ensure that victims of IPV and PSU receive the services they so desperately need. This is the end of today's session. Thank you for watching and have a good day.